Good evening, everyone, to the penultimate day of Tantrotsav 2020. Today's topic is Parvati, weds, Shiva, the divine tale of longing, penance, and love. Jataayu ji, or his actual name, Shankara Narayana, has been writing on a range of topics centered around Hindutva, cultural and social issues, and current affairs since 2005. Mostly in Tamil and occasionally in English. He is well read on Hindu philosophy, history, culture, literature and arts. He is a scholar of Tamil literature, especially the Kamba Ramayana. A collection of his Tamil essays has been published as a book, Kalandorum Narasingha, in the year 2015. He is one of the founders and editors of tamilhindu.com and also the Tamil monthly magazine, Palam. An electronics technology professional by vocation, he is currently a resident of Bengaluru, Karnataka. About the event today, on the eve of Maha Shivaratri, when we celebrate the union of Shiva and Parvati, it is a blessing to listen to the many stories behind the wedding of Parvati and Lord Shiva.
Varnanam artha sanghanam rasanam chanda samapi mangalanam chakartaro vande vani vinayakau sadashiva samarambham shankaracharya madhyamam asmadacharya paryantam Vandhe Guru Paramparam Vagartha Viva Sampriptau Vagartha Pratipattaye Jagatav Pitarau Vandhe Parvati Parameshwarau Shri Guru Pyo Namaha. Not audible?
No. Has started it?
Yeah.
Going on, right? Good evening to everyone. Namaskar. On this sacred occasion of Maha Shivaratri celebration, today we are going to listen to and meditate upon this divine episode from the Purana and Kavya literature of India called Parvati Vivah or Parvati Kalyana. So I thank Kalari Guruji and Kalari Gram institution for inviting me to give this talk on this sacred occasion. Many forms of Lord Shiva we see in temples, in icons, in literature, and in fact perhaps for people who are into meditation, even inside our heart and mind. Infinite are his forms. And two of the forms are especially delightful and worshipped across our culture. Uma Maheshwara and Ardhanarishwara. As you know, Uma Maheshwara is the form where Shiva and Parvati as divine couple are sitting together, sometimes also holding their child Skanda in their lap. And Ardhanarishwara is the beautiful form where half frame of Shiva is male and half frame is female, feminine. These forms are spoken even in the Vedas. Yate Rudra Shiva Tanura Ghora Papakashini Tayanastanu Vashanta Maya Girishanta Pichakashi. So says the Veda. O Rudra, your supremely peaceful form that destroys all the sins, Aghora Papa Kashini, may that form which is blissful, the form itself is called Shiva, Shiva Tanu, may it give us the supreme knowledge to realize us. So thus says the Veda. And if you see the words, as you know, In fact, Shankaracharya has composed two stotras on these two forms. The first one is Umaheshwara Stotra and the next one is Ardhanarishwara Stotra. So I am sure many of you may be familiar with those who are into the arts, Bharatanatyam, etc. So in the Ardhanarishwara Stotra, it ends with Namah Shivayai cha Namah Shivaya. So Shivayai is the feminine form. So the Devi is called Shiva with the longish, vowel. And the Lord is called Shivaha with the short vowel. So they both have the same name, essentially. And in Sanskrit, as you know, along with singular and plural, there is a very special form to denote what is called Dvivachanam, which is like two. So whatever is a pair, there is a special grammatical form to denote that. So in the other stotra, he says Namah Shivabhyam. And it ends with Namo Namah Shankara Parvati Bhyam in the Dvivachana. So all these three are great mantras. Namah Shivayai, Namah Shivaya, Namah Shivabhyam. So this story of Parvati longing for Shiva and marrying him, it has been spoken in many Puranas. It comes in the Ramayana. Vishwamitra tells this story to the young Rama and Lakshmana. It comes in the Mahabharata, where Rishis tell this story to Pandavas. It comes in many Puranas, the Shiva Mahapurana, Skanda Purana, Matsya Purana, Padma Purana, Linga Purana. It's a very renowned story. And Tulasidas, who wrote Ramcharitmanas in Hindi, at the start of his Ramayana, he briefly narrates this story of Parvati Vivah because it is extremely auspicious. So, today I will be mostly narrating this story based on this great Kavya called Kumarasambhavam, written by Kalidasa, the greatest of the Indian poets. So, sit back and enjoy this beautiful story. Up north, in the northern quarter's end, lies the divine soul Himalaya. Astyuttarasyam dishidevatatma Himalayo namanagadhiraja, the king of mountains, Himalaya. How he stands, purvaparau toyavidhi vakahya, sthita prithivya iva manadanda. He embraces with both his hands the eastern ocean and the western ocean, and he stands like a measuring rod for the earth, just like we have spinal cord. From the yogic perspective, it is so significant for the human body. For this earth, Himalaya kind of stands like a merudanda. So starts the poet. So this Himalaya is a king of mountains. He is also called Himavan. He has all the priceless, precious treasures of nature. The exotic plants, animals, life forms. There is even a herb called Jyotir Lata, which is supposed to give light even in darkness. It is the abode of all great things and precious things in the world. And this mountain, Himavan, is married to Mena, who is like the mind-born Manasaputri of the ancestral deities. Now you may ask, what is this? How can a mountain marry, a woman? So here in this story, like many other Hindu Purana stories, the Himavan means the mountain as well as the deity who represents the mountain. And in India, there is no natural phenomena which is not associated with a deity. So you have Ganga, Yamuna, Kaveri, you have trees, Tulasi, you have the banyan tree, the peepal tree. Every natural phenomena has a deity associated with it. So whenever the physical attributes are spoken, it is the mountain. And whenever you say, he married, he had a daughter, that refers to the deity. So this Himavan's wife, they were a lovely couple. They had an extremely happy married life going on. And in due course, Mena became pregnant, and in her womb, the Divine Mother, who is the mother of the world, entered her womb. Sati sati yoga visrishta deha taham janmane shailavadhu prapede. The Divine Mother Sati, who as Dakshayani was Shiva's wife in her previous birth. So because she could not tolerate the denigration of Shiva by her own father Daksha, so she jumped into the sacrificial fire, and in the yogagni she gave up her body. So in the next birth, she is going to be born as a daughter to Himavan and Mena. So the daughter was born, the whole world rejoiced, the entire mountain filled with delight, and she got the name Parvati. So Parvata means mountain in Sanskrit. So Parvati is the daughter of the mountain. The word Girija also means the same thing. Giri means mountain. Girija, the one born of the mountain. So when we talk of hills and mountains, they always signify loftiness, right? Their peaks rise to the sky, where the mountain itself is firmly established in the earth. So the Devi, when we say she is born as the daughter of the mountain, we can meditate upon what it really means. So all the spiritual aspirations, all the loftiness, the highest possibilities that each person can attain, that's what the mountain signifies. And Devi was born as a daughter of the mountain. So she grew up as a very lovely girl, and she was very playful, just like any other girl. She played with all her friends, the Sakhis, in the beautiful Himalaya mountains. And when the time came, all the learnings which were stored in her previous birth came to her automatically. Sthitopadesham upadeshakale prevedire praktana janma vidya, says the poet. So we see that some people, even at a very young age, are endowed with great knowledge, great skills in art. So one of the theories that our Shastras say is that all this comes from the previous birth. You know, it's impossible that at such a young age someone could have mastered all this. So just like the vasanas or the attachments continue birth after birth, even the learnings, the vidyas that one learns continues birth after birth. So in the Kavya, Kalidasa describes the beauty of the young Parvati. She grows into Yuvati. So she describes in beautiful, sublime Sanskrit poetry what is called Padavati Kesha. She actually describes her beauty. Each limb from the head to toe. So, you know, someone who is not familiar with this concept asks, what is this? You know, that this is supposed to be the Divine Mother born as a girl. And why is the poet describes her in such a sensual way? It's not just Kalidasa. So if we read Lalita Sahasranama, at the start, there is a head-to-toe description of the Devi. Saundarya Lahiri. In 100 verses, Shankaracharya sings the beauty of the Devi. So this is a form of a meditation where the quintessential beauty itself is meditated upon the Brahman, the Absolute. So once you are clear about this, you read these descriptions, it doesn't sound sensuous at all. It's very sublime. It takes you to spiritual heights. I don't have time to quote those verses. If you are interested, you can read them. And then, when she is such a lovely young girl, Devarshi Narada, who is very popular, so he just passes by the skies and he decides to drop in the Himalayas. So the Himavan welcomes him. Parvati falls at his feet. Oh, the great Rishi has come. He looks at the girl and says, oh Himavan, you are extremely fortunate, you are blessed. She is destined to marry none other than Shiva, the Mahadeva, the greatest of the gods. So, thus told by Narada, Himalaya is delighted, Himavan. But, you know, he just doesn't And as we all know, the abode of Shiva is Kailas, which is a lofty peak in the as an extension of Himalayas. So he doesn't want to just take his girl and offer it to, you know, Shiva. Oh Lord, accept my daughter. Why? Because, you know, the Shastra says that without being properly requested, the precious things should not be given. There has to be a proper request. Ayachitani na deyani. Annam vidya kanya. Food. Only when someone, you know, who is hungry, he is a patra for giving food. And vidya, knowledge. It's not, just because you have knowledge, you know, you just don't go scattering it around. And kanya, the girl. And that too, such a lovely girl endowed with all great qualities. She has to be requested, pleaded and begged for by the one who is going to marry her. So Himavan, though it is Shiva, he just didn't want to offer his daughter. But an idea struck him. He said, he knew that Shiva is into intense meditation after parting with Sati at another peak of the Himalaya. So he is living there. He is doing tapasya with Nandi and Shivaganas and all his attendants. So she said, it will be good if Parvati with her friends, Sakhis, goes and attends to her, you know, do some shushrusha, what is called a divine service, help in the puja, you know, clean the place. So all this is a prerequisite for any spiritual aspirant to make himself or herself fit for a spiritual life. So she goes, he goes along with her daughter and her friends and asks Nandikeshwara, the guardian of Shiva's ashrama, and he takes them to Shiva. And Shiva, though he is controlling all his senses, mind and everything, and absorbed in the Paramatman consciousness, he allows these young beautiful maidens to come and serve him. Because, you know, he is a dhira, he is valiant, he is brave. He is sure that he is not going to be assailed by the beauty of these girls. So he allows. So why is Shiva doing such a great tapas? You know, he is the lord of the world. Svayam vidhata tapasah phalanam. So he is the vidhata, he is the maker of the destiny, who distributes fruits of the tapasya to everyone, every mortal, every human who is doing the penance. Why is he himself absorbed in such deep penance? The poet says, kenapi kamena tapaschachare. Due to some desire, he was in penance. We don't know. We don't know the divine secret. But the commentators say that, you know, the Lord, the Ishvara, he doesn't have anything to do, anything to gain. In the Gita, Bhagavan says, name parthasti kartavyam tishu lokeshu kinchan. Arjuna, I don't have anything to do in the three worlds, but still, I am always absorbed in work. Why? If I sit lazy, this whole humanity that follows me will sit lazy. So the human has to get himself into a karma, a work, and then later sublimate that work itself into worship and a spiritual sadhana. And just to show to this world that everyone should do tapasya, the Lord, the Shiva, sat in tapasya. And what a beautiful form it is. You see the calendar picture of Shiva. The most popular calendar picture of Shiva, at least in the North India, right, is that beautiful depiction of him with half-closed eyes, sitting as a tapasvi on the tiger skin. So it has captured the imagination of all the yogis and poets and jnanis for centuries. So just for that purpose, perhaps he sat in meditation, so that we can meditate upon him as a tapasvi. So Parvati is serving Shiva. It's all going on beautifully. So what does she do? So every day she brings flowers, she brings water, she brings what is called the kusha grass. You know, it is that small grass which people put in the homa and for worship. and she cleans the place where he sits and meditates. So all these kind of divine service she is doing. Now the scene shifts to Devaloka. So the all devas are terrified because there is this cruel asura called Taraka. So who has got some unassailable boon from Brahma, the creator god, and he is wreaking havoc on all the three worlds. So he is destroying human, he is destroying the devas, and they all go to the creator god, Brahma, and tell him that, Lord, how can we come out of this? You know, all our divine powers, including those of Vishnu and all the great devas, are futile in front of this asura. So you are the ones who made him, you are the one who made him and gave him all these boons. You know, so please, now you yourself have to give a solution. So then Brahma says, children, it's not possible. You know, so the fate of the destiny is such that I cannot bring his end. So only a commander, a senapati, who is born with the union of Shiva and Parvati, can bring his end. Nothing else can relieve this world of this asura called Taraka. So then devas are in major worry because, you know, they know that Shiva is, he has cast away all the desires and he is absorbed in deep meditation. And when will he marry and when will a son be born and he will lead the divine armies in a battle against Taraka? And then Manmatha, the god of love, he is also called Kamadeva, right? So this Manmatha is an interesting character. So he has a bow made of sugarcane, and in his quiver are five arrows. They are just five flowers: Ashoka, Nilottala, Kamala, lotus, and all those beautiful flowers. So he just shoots those flower arrows on all species in the creation, and then shot by those arrows, the feeling of mutual love, the feelings of conjugal love arise in all beings. So Manmatha walks in and devas plead him, oh, you know, even the great rishis, you were able to defeat them. There is none in the three worlds who does not get attacked by, who escapes from the attack by your flower arrows. So now you have to help us. So you have to, you know, this intense tapasya of Shiva, you somehow have to bring this to end. Okay, so Manmatha is very confident of his powers and, you know, the hold that he has on the entire nature and human, everything. So he has, his wife is Rati. So Rati is nothing but a feminine goddess of love. So, you know, a love is not a singular thing. So that there has to be a love and the beloved. So Manmatha's wife is Rati. So they always go as a pair. And they have an accomplice called Vasanta. Who is the, Vasanta means spring season in Sanskrit. So spring obviously is the best of the seasons. Because Rutunam Kusumakaraha, says Bhagavan in the Gita. In the seasons, I am the spring season. So anyone, like all of us who have grown up in India, we know how beautiful spring gets in all parts of our country. In fact, our great festivals like Vasanta Panchami, Holi, they all come during the spring season. It is also the season where traditionally the Madanotsava was celebrated, where young people will get out in the moonlight, they will sing, dance, they experience joy and all that. So this Vasanta is an accomplice of Manmatha. So all three, they go to this Himalayan grove where Shiva is in deep tapas. And then, it is not the spring season. It is some autumn, something, some summer. And suddenly, Manmatha, with his powers, changes it into a spring season. And the whole creation in the Himalaya gets agitated. They just don't know what is happening. It's an untimely spring. So even the rishis, their minds are perturbed and tempted. and you know, the bees are engrossed in love. A male elephant walks by the fountain, and suddenly he feels love, and he just takes a beehive with his tusk and just feeds it to his female love. So the poet describes the scenes of the spring season so beautifully. The Gandharva, not just the animals, the humans, even the divine beings like Gandharvas, who are like the celestial musicians, Kinnaras, Vidyadharas. So every one of them are suddenly the love arises in their hearts. And even Shiva Ganas are not spared. Suddenly the Shiva Ganas start doing some funny things. When the untimely spring sets in, and the Nandikeshwara notices it, and he senses there is some trouble here. So with his powers, he makes the entire surrounding of the grove where Shiva is doing penance still. You know, no leaves are moving, no cuckoo bird is singing in its deep voice to arouse love in everyone. Peacocks are not dancing. The whole grove is like a still painting. It is there, but no movement. To such a place, Manmatha enters. And then, slowly, you know, he wants to move to a place away from the sight of Nandikeshwara. So he goes inside some bushes and he watches. What a scene! So in a platform that is sanctified, there's a tiger skin spread. On that platform sits Mahadeva in Virasana. He sits with his jata is tied beautifully with a snake. He is wearing a deer skin matching in color with the black neck, the Neelakantha. Such intense meditation he is sitting. Poet says, Avrishti samram, avrishti samrambham ivambuvaham apamibadharam anuttarangam antascharanam marutam nirodhan nivatanishkam pamivapradipam. Like a cloud not blustering to burst into a shower, like a reservoir of water unruffled with ripples, like a steady lamp in a windless pot. Nivata nishkampa miva pradipam. Shiva sits there. Antascharana maruta nirodhan. All the vital airs that are going inside his body, he restrained all of them. The moment Manmatha sees this posture of Shiva, he thinks, forget shooting an arrow at him. Manasa pyadrishya. He is not to be assailed even in the mind and in the thought. Not physically, even in my mind, I cannot think of assailing him. And then the bow and the arrows are about to slip from his hands. At that moment, Parvati walks in with his sakis. It is her roti, daily roti, right? It is the time to serve Shiva. So she comes with her sakis, holding me. And she also notices that there is an untimely spring. So she is decorated with all the flowers that blossom during the Vasanta Ritu. So the reddish Ashoka flower, and the golden Karnikara flower, and the whitish Sudhamukha flowers. So instead of any jewel, she is just decked with these beautiful flowers of the exotic Himalayan forest. When she is walking, it is as if a creeper laden with flowers is walking. And she has her offerings in her hand. She has a garland made out of the dried lotus leaves. You know? So people make tulasi mala with dried tulasi leaves. So in a similar way, there was a custom to make, with lotus beads, people make akshamala. So Parvati made one such mala to offer to Shiva. So she comes in, Nandikeshwara lets her in. So she comes in front of Shiva. And she offers the flowers. She offers the mala at Shiva's neck. At that, so noticing all this, now the Manmatha got emboldened. Okay, so the bowstring that he has, so he just keep playing with his bowstring. Wow, wow, I was about to give up. Now this is the time. So, then Parvati does a namaskara to Shiva. She prostrates in front of him. And then the Shiva blesses him. Ananya bhajam pati maapnuhi iti. Oh girl, oh maiden, you will get a husband who doesn't look at any other girl. What more of a blessing a girl who is looking for a husband can get? And then the poet says, you know, the sayings of the great men, the sayings of Mahatmas, never go in vain. Didn't it happen in the case of Parvati? So, Shiva, not just that he doesn't look at any other woman, he gave half of his body to her. What more can a husband do to his wife? So, with his blessing, so Parvati gets up. At that moment, who is like a firefly, desperate to fall into this burning lamp and die. So that is the upama, that is the comparison, the simile that the poet gives. You know, he's so desperate, like a firefly, which is going to fall into a lamp. So Manmatha shoots this astra called Sammohana. So it is a love missile. So there are five types of love missiles. The most powerful is Sammohana, which means enchanting. So this is the first missile that he shoots whenever he wants to attack people. So what are the other astras? There is Tapana, which makes people burn with love. And then Shoshana, which makes people, saps all energy and drives them up in love. Unmadana, makes them mad, intoxicated. Stambhana, makes them stupefied. So these are the five types of love missiles that the god of love, Manmatha, has in his quiver. And he shoots the Sammohana Astra on the Lord. When he does that, there is a stirring in the whole environment. How was it? Poet says, Chandroda Yarambha Ivambu Rashi. At the very beginning of the moonlight, how the ocean stirs. So there is a belief, it's a Puranic belief, and it's also scientifically true that whenever on full moon days, right, when the moon is in all its glory in the sky, the waves of the ocean get very agitated. So you will see that there is intense activity on the wave front on full moon days. But just when the moon sets in, it slowly stops. There is a small stirring in the ocean. Just like that there was a stir. And then Shiva sees Parvati. So till now he has been seeing her, but he has not been seeing in that sense. So she sees her with all his three eyes. Okay? And Parvati also sees him, and she can't bear the love rays emanating out of them. So she just lowers her eyes like this. The poet says, Paryasta Vilochanena. So she expresses her love that way. And just a moment, then Shiva gets his composure back and he wants to see who caused this stirring here. So he just turns around and in the hiding of those bushes, he sees Manmatha. What happened? Krodham prabho samhara samhareti. Krodham prabho samhara samhareti yavad gira khe marutam charanti tavat savanhir bhavanetra janma bhasma vasesham madanam chakara bhasma vasesham madanam chakara. Prabho, restrain your anger. Devas are shouting from the sky. Even before those shouts could reach his ears, Krodham Prabho, Samhara, Samhara, shouting. The fire born out of Bhava's third eye just comes, and in that very moment only ashes are left. There is no Manmatha, no bow, no arrows, nothing. Just ashes. Rati sees this and faints. Parvati doesn't know what to do. Shiva, with his ganas, just leaves the place. And Parvati is dejected. She is heartbroken. All the service that I did to win him went in vain. What will I do? She goes back to her father's house. And Rati, she cries, what will happen to the world? If there is no God of love and love, how will the world go on? And then there is Ashariri rising in the sky. There is a voice that says, oh Rati, do not despair. You know, Manmatha got reduced to ashes. His body is not there. He became Ananga, but he will be visible to your eyes. When Shiva weds Parvati, he will come alive. So with that reassurance, so the Rati is consoled. And then Parvati decides, what is the use of beauty or any good quality or life itself when it doesn't receive love from the beloved? Priyeshu saubhagya phalahi charuta. Then she decides, I could not win Shiva with my service and my beauty. Now I will win him with my penance. I will do tapasya. Why? So tapasya, literally the tapaha means burning. So when you burn yourself, that's what is tapasya. Always. The Upanishad says, tapo brahmeti. It says, with tapa, one attains Brahman. So then she goes to a place, a beautiful, she goes alone. There are no sakhis this time. She goes alone, initially. And she makes a nice tapovana there. And that Himalayan peak where she went, the poet says that later the whole world is going to know it by her own name called Gauri Shikhara. So whatever we call as Gauri Shankar today, it is the peak where Parvati is supposed to have done tapasya. The Gauri Shikhara, she goes there. And she does intense tapasya. So she has abandoned all her jewels and decorations and everything. She wears what is called Valkala, a dress made of bark. She doesn't have all those exotic, you know, chandana, kumkuma, and the luxuries that are used to make the body beautiful and attractive. And she sleeps on the floor with just hands as her pillow. And she baths in the ice cold water of the Himalayan snow every day. And the only company she has are the deers that have beautiful eyes like her own, and then there are plants that she is growing. And the Maharshis who are living nearby in the Himalayan peaks, they come to know of her tapas, and they come to see this young girl, and they are amazed, and they tell her, oh, at such young age you are doing this tapas. They respect her and they go away. She thinks that her tapas is still not good enough. And then she undertakes what is called a Panchagni tapas, where she creates fire on four sides, and at the fifth fire there is the sun. She is standing in the middle of them in peak summer and does intense tapasya. And then the seasons come and go, her tapasya continues. When the rainy season comes, the first drop of the rainy season, prathamoda bindavaha, those first drops, they just fall in her half-closed eyelids. Then they touch her lips and kiss her. They scatter on her breasts. They touch their navel, nabhi, and then they fall to her feet. It is like the nature itself doing abhisheka to the devi who is doing penance. This is a very beautiful verse and usually quoted by Sanskrit scholars as just describing the feminine beauty. But if you read it with a spiritual mindset, it looks like as if the nature itself is doing abhisheka to Devi when she is doing the penance. And how does she subsist? The highest sadhana in the tapasya is not making any effort to earn food. So she is only eating leaves that just fall by themselves, the dried leaves from the trees, just eats them. At some point, she even gives that up. And that's how she got the name Aparna. So Parna means the one who lives on leaves. Because she even left that, she was called Aparna. In fact, even when she was undertaking this tapas, her mother, Mena, prevented her. Oh girl, why are you making yourself so much? Why are you undergoing so much pain? There are all the devas are there in the Himalayas. Why do you want to? They will give you health, wealth, all the luxuries, everything. Why do you have to take this penance? So she was stopped by her mother from doing penance. The mother says, "Ooh, ma." Ooh means oh or child. Ma means don't do tapas. And that's how she got the name Uma. So Parvati is doing such intense penance. And Shiva, the poet just says that she went away. Of course, she is also doing penance somewhere else. So, why was Shiva doing penance? Now it becomes very clear. She was doing tapasya to get Parvati. Parvati is doing tapasya to get Shiva. Shiva is doing tapas to get Parvati. You know? Paraspara tapasiddhau, says the great saint Appayadikshita. It is a mutual penance. If you see, our great land itself is the land of tapasya. In the Kailasa, Shiva is ever doing tapas, eternal tapasya. In the northern tip, in the southern tip, Kanyakumari, standing on the rock, she is doing eternal tapasya. So tapasya in Kailasa, tapasya in Kanyakumari, in between is this great land of Bharatavarsha. What a sublime and spiritual message. Thanks. Shankara says in Shivananda Lahari, Nija tapas phalabhyam bhakteshu prakatita phalabhyam. So they were both each other fruits of each other's penance to themselves. He says, Nija tapas phalabhyam. And there is a great message here. Everything in life, you know, you have to do penance to get it. Whether it is beauty, whether it is knowledge, whether it is art, whether it is kalari, whether it is yoga, anything, you have to do penance to get it. Wife, husband, child, everyone should be prayed for in life. See, that's why in our Indian languages, it's very difficult to express that feeling in English. So in Hindi they say, Janam janam se tapasya kar rahe hun. Tum jaise bachya ko paane ke liye. Very common expression. In Tamil we say, Thavamirundu petta pillai. It is so imbibed in our language itself that everyone should do penance to get whatever he or she wants. So when this is going on, some sakis come here and they see her tapas and they said they decide to stay with her. And after some time, one brahmachari walks in. Brahmachari is looking very bright. From his very face, it appears that he has learnt all the Vedas, everything. He is beautifully dressed with the robes meant for brahmacharis. He has a jata and he walks in. And to Parvati's tapovana, they all welcome him. A great spiritual person has come. So after they do arghya, patya, all the welcoming ceremonies to him, he is relaxed. And then he starts praising Parvati. I have heard about your tapas. The Himalaya is already great. It's already sanctified. With your tapasya, you have made it more sanctified. Oh, Uttalakshi, the one with eyes like beautiful blue lotus. She addresses her like that. Sharira madhyam khalu dharma sadhanam. It's a very famous. Your body is essentially the instrument for dharma. So you have to protect your body. Oh girl, why are you torturing it like this? You just do tapasya as much as your body permits. Do a very comfortable tapasya. Why are you torturing it like this? And what is the motive for your tapasya? Are you short of wealth? It's there everywhere in Himalaya. Do you want a good birth? You are already born to Himavan, the greatest divine soul. Or are you afflicted with some grief for which you are doing such a tapas? It doesn't look like that from your face. Or just like all young girls do, are you doing tapasya to get a husband? But why you have to do that? Oh Bhamini, the beautiful one. Na ratna manvishyati mrityate tat. A priceless gem doesn't go seeking. It is sought for. The one who wants to get the gem, they come seeking. Why do you have to go seeking it? I think this must be the reason. But the man that you desire, he must be a very harsh fellow. Even after seeing you doing such ghora tapasya, that guy is not moved. He is too arrogant. Maybe he is too hot-headed with his qualities and his duty and everything. I'll do half of my tapasya to you. Please give up this and go back to your home. And then Parvati looks at her friend and the friend starts speaking. So the friend says, she has set her eyes on the one who is Arupa Haryaha, the one who cannot be won by beauty, the one who burnt Manmatha. But before burning, the Manmatha's arrows went deep into her heart. How did it happen? He was looking at her with all his three eyes. Suddenly the Manmatha's arrow came, and then a hunkara came from his mouth that diverted the direction of the arrow. So instead of hitting him, it has hit her. Now she is deeply afflicted by Manmatha's arrows. And whenever she is singing Shiva's glory in her sweet voice, she can't even complete the song. Her heart chokes. She suddenly wakes up from the sleep at midnight. Oh Nilakanta, where are you going? She starts speaking like a mad woman. Such is her state. When will Shiva shower her grace? Like the rain that drenches a ploughed earth. She is like a ploughed earth. She is already matured with so much of tapasya. Visheva sitam tadavagra kshatam, she says. Then the brahmachari turns around to Parvati and asks, is it a joke or is it really like this? Aida mevam parihasa. Shiva, you are doing tapasya to get Shiva? Then Parvati says, yes, that's what I am doing. Manoratharam agatir navityate. If I set my mind with pure heart and determination, what all I cannot attain? Oh! Then Brahmachari says, no, I didn't mean that. I know this person, Shiva. He is a highly inauspicious man I have ever seen. He is the epitome of Amangala. You know? So, oh, girl, you are fit to wear beautiful golden bangles in your hands. But that person, he is wearing snakes all over his body. You are supposed to wear fine silk embroidered with swans in its borders. Kalahamsa lakshanam vadhu dukulam. This Shiva, what is he wearing? Gajajinam. He is wearing a blood-stained elephant hide. Oh, how disgusting. And your body is fit to be anointed with sandal paste. This person, ashes from the pyre, that's what he is. You are fit to ride a royal elephant, the daughter of Himalaya. But this Shiva, he just rides a very old bull who can't even walk. Moon was the only good thing that he has. But even that moon, Chandra Kala, it lost its 16th Kala because he wore it. So that the tradition is that he can see only 15 Kalas of the moon. You know, the 15 faces of the moon. And the 16th Kala is hidden. And that's the Kala which is on Shiva's head. Your fate is also going to become like that. So he goes on and on. And on top of all this, when you look for a husband, the first thing you look at is his background, his lineage, his family. Nothing is known about his birth. Nobody knows whom he was born to. Where is he? Where are you? And where is he? So he goes on and on. Parvati gets very angry. Her face becomes red. Her eyebrows are twitch. And then she says, stop, Brahmachari. You don't understand Shiva in real. She says, Aloka samanya achintya hetukam drishanti mandas charitam mahatmana. Just because it is different from all ordinary people, just because it is non-comprehensible, because you cannot comprehend it. The people of low intellect, they always hate ways of great people. Looks like even from the days of Shiva and Parvati, it has been like that. So Parvati speaks this to the Brahmachari. And she says, he is Vishwamurti. You know, the whole universe is his body. The whole universe is his body. And anything in the world can become his ornament. Gold can become his ornament, and snake can also become his ornament. And what is the use of all these objects to decorate him? Who is the refuge of the whole world? Jagat Sharanyam. He is Bhima Rupa, terrible, but he is also called Shiva, which means auspicious. Even the ash from the pyre, because he anoints it his own, his body becomes a purifier. The whole world wears it to purify their mind. So anyway, whatever you think, and last thing you said, that is correct. His birth is not known because he is anadi. No beginning, no end. He is the absolute. That thing you said right. Whatever you may think of him, my mind has one pointed love towards him. And then she turns to the Sakhi and says, let's go wherever the Mahatmas are abused. It's not just the person who is speaking, even those who listens to those denigrating words, they acquire the sin. Let's go. So then she turns around and starts moving. And suddenly, a hand clasps her hand. Adya prabhrityavanatangitavas midasaha kritas tapobhirti vadini chandra maulau ahakvayasa nisamadigam nikamajam kalamutsu sarja. Kleshaf phale naki punar navatam vidhatte. And a sweet voice he heard. Adya prabhuti avanatangi tava asmi dasa. From this day onwards, oh girl with beautiful limbs, I am your slave. Kritas tapobhihi, you have bought me with your tapasya. She turns around slowly and she sees Chandramouli, the one with moon on his head, is standing there on his beautiful form. At that very moment, Parvati doesn't know all the sufferings, all the pain that she has undergone. Everything appears to have vanished that very moment. And it is as if she is born again, born anew. And then Parvati obviously is blushed. She is blushing. Like, you know, whenever a man proposes his love to a girl, even if she is Parvati, that's how she reacts to it. And then she tells her friend, she just shows her eyes, you know, tell him. So then the Sakhi says, oh Lord, you please come and ask for her hand to Himavan, her father. And then they both leave. And then Shiva, in his mind, meditates the Sapta Rishis. And the seven Rishis come. The seven Rishis stay, you know, their abode is above the Surya Mandala. From there, they come along with Arundhati, who is the wife of Vasishtha. They all come. Shiva expresses his desire to them. So then the Sapta Rishis go to Himavan with Shiva's proposal. Himavan, this is what he has been waiting on all the time. And then he says, the Rishis tell him, they speak so beautifully. The poet says, Tamarthamiva Bharatya Sudaya Yoktumarhasi. You give your daughter and join her with Shiva, like joining word with its meaning. See how beautifully the Rishis are speaking. Tamarthamiva Bharatya. Like you join word with meaning, you join your daughter with Shiva. What does that mean? Can a meaning ever separate? Can meaning be ever separate from the word? That is how Shiva and Shakti are. So Kalidasa, in the starting verse of Raghuvamsha, says, Vagartha viva sampriptav, Vagartha pratipattai. The ones who are ever united, like word and its meaning, to those Parvati and Parameshwara, my salutations. So Rishis echo the same sentiment here. So the Shiva Shakti Tattva is very beautiful. Shiva Shakti Aika Rupini is the last penultimate, the last but one Nama in Lalita Sahasranama. Devi herself symbolizes the unity of Shiva and Shakti. Shiva, the manifested power of Shiva is Shakti, and the dormant power is Shiva. So beautifully the Rishis speak this, and then the Himavan says, he agrees, and he says, Sarvesham eva dananam, kanyadanam visishyate. Danam, giving something itself, giving itself is great. Of all the givings, giving a girl to a suitable groom is the highest dana. So unfortunately, you know, some of these half-baked feminists of our country, they are saying that kanya dana means you are treating the woman like an object, and that is why you are giving dana. But even knowledge, you say vidya dana, you know, when you impart knowledge to someone, that is also called dana. So when you give kanya as a dana to someone, it is an act which brings the greatest punya as per our shastras. Even Himavan has done it. So unfortunately, you know, all the great shastric injunctions and the cultural values and the rituals, or when they get interpreted by people who really don't know their meaning, they sound nice and radical at the first minute, but when you deeply think upon it, it's absurd. It's killing the whole aesthetics of a wedding, right? So the whole aesthetics of the Hindu wedding is that the father of the bride, he gives his kanya, his girl, as a dana to a person who is suitable for her, who is good or better than her in all qualities and beauty and everything, for the dharma to propagate. So that is why she is called Dharma Patni. And this is the manner in which even Shiva himself marries Parvati. Then what to say of our mortals like us? And then the poet beautifully describes. They fix the marriage after 3 days. The rishis go. And the Kavya says that the day on which their marriage happened is Uttara Phalguni Nakshatra, which means in the Phalguna month, the Uttara Phalguni Nakshatra. So if you see that this particular day mostly falls on the holy festival. Okay? The holy is the Purnima in the Vasanta Ritu. And on that day, the nakshatra is 80% of the time is Uttara Phalguni. In Tamil Nadu, we have this festival Panguni Uttiram, which actually means Uttara Phalguni. So the wedding of Shiva and Parvati is celebrated in a grand manner in our culture from time immemorial. In fact, holy festival. So the original traditional explanation of holy festival is Shiva Parvati wedding. The Holika Dahan is the next one. It is not the first one. And then the poet describes how they undergo every wedding related ritual, you know, so beautifully. Though they are divine beings, so Parvati does the Mangala Snana. She is decorated so beautifully, and with all the jewels and flowers and everything. And one of her sakis, who applies that reddish dye in her feet, it is considered as very auspicious. Even today, you will see Hindu woman wearing that reddish dye in her feet on the day of marriage. So she tells her, "Oh girl, you are going to kick the moon with this, and the moon will become red." What does this mean? So this is a very rasokti, as they call it. What she says is, you know, so when you will marry Shiva, and obviously there will be some playful love quarrel between you both. No couple can escape that. And Shiva is definitely going to fall at your feet. So at that time, you just kick that moon and make the moon red. So this is how the sakis talk to her. So there is joy and delight all over the Himalaya. And Vishnu, Brahma and all the devas come to the wedding. So in a similar manner, Shiva also gets decorated. And at a moment, all his so-called decorations become real decorations. The snakes become, his crown, his bracelet and his necklace and everything. The poet says, "Oh, the snake's body became gold, but the priceless gems that were on the hoods of the snakes, the Nagaratna, they don't have to change. They just remained gems." Because there is a belief that there are gems in the hoods of the snakes in India. I don't know whether it's there in other cultures. It's called Nagaratna or Nagamani, right? Only the Naga has to change, the money remains the same. And the ashes become the sandal paste, and so that way the Shiva comes as the most handsome man to the wedding, and the wedding ceremony takes place. And there are so many folk songs. It's called Shivji Ki Barat in Hindi and many North Indian languages, and even in Bengali, I think there is Parvati Mangal and other. There are songs in many Indian languages celebrating the wedding of Shiva and Parvati. And on one side, there are these hill people, you know, the mountain tribes and the people of Himalaya country. And on the other side, on the bride side, there are all mountain people. And on the groom side, there are people from Devaloka and all the three worlds. The moment they enter the city, they both simply mingle with each other. How? Poet gives a beautiful example there. Vinnaika Setu. There is a small check dam. There is a bund which is built across a river. You would have seen this in many places in India. Small, you know, a dam built with mud. And suddenly if that dam breaks, the river on both sides just merge. So that's how the mountain people and the devas mingled with each other. The humanity and divinity met and they mingled with each other. And how was the luster of Shiva and Parvati? How was their beauty? How good they looked on their wedding day? That's the, you know, that is the foremost worry among everyone getting married. The poet beautifully says here, in every bride and groom in the world, at the moment of their wedding, the presence of Shiva and Parvati sets in. Now the sannidhya of Shiva and Parvati sets in every bride and groom that is getting married. And then they shine with divine luster, kanti, at that moment of their wedding. If such is the case, what can I speak of the original wedding of Shiva and Parvati when they themselves got married? So, such was the glory of the wedding of Shiva and Parvati. And with this, I bring my discourse to a conclusion. Yashivo nama rupa bhyam ya devi sarvamangala tayoho samsmarana deva sarvatra jayamangalam sarve bhavantu sukhinaha sarve santu niramayaha sarve bhadrani pasyantu ma kaschit dukkha bhag bhavet.